Hello everyone, welcome to this material characterization course. In this class, I would like to discuss about the sample preparation techniques for TEM analysis. You have to understand one thing, the sample preparation is the biggest task as far as the TEM analysis goes. It takes a lot of pains to prepare a suitable sample, and getting a suitable sample is almost becoming it's a very long process because you need to produce a sample with lot of care, because you want to produce a very thin section without, incorporating an external strain or contamination in order to characterize the material in its original form. So it becomes very difficult to prepare a sample, and also it requires a lot of patience and time. So I will just go through some of the basic principles which has been, which underlying the specimen preparation, and also I will just show some of the laboratory demonstration in taking you through all the tools which we have in our electron microscopy laboratory. I will just briefly give a presentation on various techniques adopted for a sample preparation, whether it is a metal, a ceramic, or a polymer, or a powder, and so on. So then we will take up a corresponding individual case studies. So most of the information is taken from this textbook by David Williams and Barry Carter. If you look at the overview of the specimen preparation could take time from 10 minutes to 1 or 2 days, depending upon what we want to learn from the material. There are two types of specimens: self-supporting specimen, specimen resting on a supporting grid. We will look at what is these two types. And mechanical thinning, when I say mechanical thinning, I am keeping a material like metals and ceramics in mind. So we will also show the procedures of what is mechanical thinning. And the ideal way to do this job is to using the spark erosion or electric discharge machining instead of doing manually. This is also we will demonstrate. A rule of thumb is any abrasive will produce a damage to 3 times their grid size above and below the surface. Hence, the final disc must be thicker than the 2x the damage depth, or else the mechanical damage depth will always be visible in the final specimen. So what we are trying to say here is, we are simply talking about a mechanical thinning. You will see that we will be demonstrating how to prepare a thin metallic sample or a ceramic sample, where we will be rubbing this specimen against an emery paper or an abrasive paper. So you have to be very careful about this, because this abrasive paper will have in itself, it will produce a damage up to 3 times its grid size. So the grid size of the emery paper is important. So you have to take a very fine emery paper if you have a very thin sample, otherwise it will produce its own damage, which is not a characteristic of a material itself. So you have chemicals which we use in our specimen preparation. You have HCN, HF, HNO3, HClO4. You have to be very careful, because most of them are poisonous and explosives. And then you have this perchloric acid, that is HClO4 plus ethanol or methanol. Mixture is called universal polish. That means most of the metals, if you use this as an electrolyte, that will polish. So what we are now specifically talking about is a mechanical thinning followed by an electrolytic polishing. We will get into the detail, but since in earlier days the analysis was primarily done on a metallic sample, and these are the techniques were developed in the beginning. So now you have sample preparation techniques for other materials such as ceramics, polymers and biological and powder and so on. So we will just also follow that order. We will just look at first metallic samples, and still more relevant, people are using it. And then this technique which is specific for ceramics and polymers, I will just keep mentioning it then and there. So the electrolyte mixture, perchloric, acetic and water phase diagram is very important, because as I mentioned in the previous slide, this is mostly used as a universal polishing electrolyte. So if you see that phase diagram, this is perchloric acid, water, and then this is acetic acid. It shows the hazardous regions and the recommended density line for a safe use of all the perchloric solutions. So you see that you have a boundary with which if you mix these three acids, it will be flammable or it could be an explosive also. So you have a safe line under which you have to operate whenever you produce a electrolyte for the metal thinning or material thinning. So just to give that point, this slide is brought. And some of the sample preparation accessories are shown in this slide. This is a punching machine, a sheet punching machine, and then these are all grits of various kinds. And this is the, you would say that this is foldable grits where you can keep your sample inside, and then it is locked so that it is safe and intact. So we will go through all this when we actually take up some practical examples. A mechanical punch for stamping a disc from this thin sheets of ductile materials. So this punching machine will produce a metallic specimen of 3 mm disc in order to suitably placed in a sample holder in a TEM. So we will also show you the actual sample holder, how it is being used. A sheet sample is placed in the punch as indicated, and the handle on the right is pushed down, ejecting 3 mm diameter disc suitable for thinning. So it is, I will show the live demonstration, so don't worry about it. And why 3 mm? Because it has to suit the sample holder. A variety of specimen support grades of different mesh size and shape. At the top right is the oyster grade, useful for sandwiching small silvers of thin materials. So this is for sandwiching this sample. And then you also have a dimpling apparatus. This is all coming under the pre-thinning apparatus category. We have this machine in our laboratory, we will demonstrate, but the principle is simple. A surface dimpling using a chemical solution, example to remove the silicon from one side of the disc. The light pipe permits the visual detection of the perforation using the mirror. So this is the setup. So you have the etchant, and then this is the jet, and this is a sample is kept on this, and you have the mirror to view it, and the light will pass through this perforation once the etching is complete, which produces a hole in this tube. A dimpling apparatus showing a grinding tool and a specimen supporting block. So you have the sample will be kept here, typically a ceramic sample will be kept here, and then this wheel will grind this specimen and make a dimple That's called that's why it's named dimpling apparatus. We will actually show you the demo how it is done. And then mostly the electro polishing is called final thinning. So you have the typical IV characteristics, that is current voltage characteristic of an electrolytic reaction. You have etching region, you have a polishing region, and then pitting region. So before you start any of this electrolytic polishing, you have to characterize the electrolytic action. So you have to choose an appropriate current and voltage in order to stay in this polishing region, otherwise it is again a very tricky situation. And you can see that you have this kind of a layer which forms on the specimen. You have the specimen here, a viscous fluid film and then electrolyte. And you have a thin solid oxide film also forms on the specimen. We will see how to handle this. And one of the criterion for using this electro polishing technique is it's only electrically conducting materials, no mechanical damage, but surface chemistry can change and hazardous to the health. You have to be careful, better to wear a precautionary tools and safety devices before we engage in this exercise. And so what this curve shows, electro polishing curve showing the increase in the current between the cathode as the applied voltage is increased. Polishing occurs on the plateau, etching at the lower voltage and pitting at the higher voltage. So the ideal conditions for obtaining a polished surface require a formation of a viscous film between the electrolyte and the specimen surface. So this is an ideal condition for the specimen preparation. So how do we make sure that? So we have an automatic machine which characterizes the ideal conditions for polishing. I will show you when I demonstrate this action in the laboratory. And the another type of jet polishing is shown here. Basically, you have the two methods. What we have in our laboratory is this method. You have a twin jet, you have the sample in between, and this is a recirculated electrolyte, and then you have the pump which passes the electrolyte through these two nozzles and then producing the a dimple on both sides and eventually make a perforation inside the sample, and that forms your final sample for the TEM analysis. So first one is electro polishing by allowing a single jet of electrolyte, and this is a twin jet electrolyte. So this is a gravity led electrolyte to thin a disc supported on a positively charged gaze. So this is one method. And what we are going to demonstrate in the laboratory is this. And as I mentioned, this is a twin. It's called a twin jet polisher. So the disc must be rapidly extracted from the electrolyte and washed in the solvent to remove any residual electrolyte which may etch the surface. This is very important operation in a jet polishing. Once the sample is taken out from the jet polishing unit, you see, you have to remember that the electrolyte is still sticking to both the surfaces. So you have to rapidly clean this specimen which is taken out of this electrolyte and thoroughly washed with the water, not in one beaker, or you have to keep three beakers with an alcohol, and then you have to rapidly agitate the specimen to remove, in order to remove the electrolyte from both sides, so that the etching action is stopped and then your which will eat away your material slowly, which you may not see it with your naked eye, but it will, once you put it under a microscope, you will see that that is more important. I will also show this aspect. I am telling this right now itself because this is one place where people fail and then they don't get the good sample of after electrolytic polishing. So this is very important step. Undoubtedly, you get a better at electropolishing with the practice. Obviously, this is a kind of, you know, it's a recipe. Everybody will have their own way of doing things because electrolytic reaction is depending upon so many factors which one has to look at: the current, the voltage, the specimen condition, the sample surface condition. Everything will vary a person to person or a specimen to specimen with which they are handling. So even your pre-thinning operations will have a significant role to play in an electrolytic polishing. For example, if you are not very careful with the abrasive thinning or mechanical thinning, where and then you may be using a glue to stick this foil onto a bulk sample, and if you don't remove the glue properly, then also your electrolytic reaction will not be proper. Maybe one side it is stuck with the glue, the other side is exposed to the electrolyte. So it will be a non-uniform thinning will take place. And one very important aspect everybody forgets in this exercise is, suppose if you do the electrolytic polishing, before you come to the electrolytic polishing, you better to look at the sample under the optical microscope, both sides, whether you have any contamination sticking onto your sample. It could be a debris from the emery paper or abrasive paper, or it could be a glue which is still sticking at one of the edges, or it should be, if it is stored in an open space, dust particles or any other foreign material which will be sitting on the sample, which you may not observed with a naked eye. And it is essential that you observe this sample under an optical microscope before you come to electrolytic polishing. Then you will, if you follow that procedures and then follow the jet polishing procedures, I am 100% sure you will be able to produce a nice hole in the sample with a very large thin area. So the importance I will just show you when we put the sample in the microscope, and then you will appreciate what I am now talking about. So it comes with the practice, but reproducing the correct condition of temperature, electrolytic solution, chemistry, stirring rate, applied voltage, polishing current, etc., can only be achieved through trial and error. So this is another important point you have to remember. You have to do few trials before you come out with the proper combination of parameters. Keeping the records of each experiment is very important of this to stabilize this jet polishing. The another important technique is iron milling. This particular technique is especially meant for a non-metallic samples, especially ceramic samples. So we'll briefly go through this schematic where it demonstrates how the basic functions of the iron milling machine. You have the specimen which is kept there, and then you have the circuit iron gun which comes and impinges on the specimen surface, and it will start to thin. We will see what it is. So the schematic diagram of an iron beam thinning device will look like this. Argon gas bleeds into an ionization chamber where a potential up to 6 kilo electron volt creates a beam of argon ions that impinge on the rotating specimen. So this specimen is rotating, that is what shown in this arrow. So the beam of argons will fall on this specimen surface. We will see, we will also show the actual machine, how this operation is carried out. The whole apparatus is under vacuum. The specimen may be cooled to a liquid nitrogen temperatures, and perforation is detected by a penetration of ions through the specimen. So in fact, you will see that the specimen is being thinned and by both the directions. So, and also in some of the machines you have the cooling system which can go up to liquid nitrogen temperature, and some of these systems will not have the liquid nitrogen setup. So the iron impingement on the both sides will be there, and you can see that and then how nicely the thinning takes place in this particular region where both the beam impinges on the sample on on the straight line. Please remember the pre-thinned samples are only put on the iron milling machine, not the bulk sample, which is very important. So this is again very very delicate to handle it, because if you are not performing the pre-thinning exercise much more carefully, again this iron milling is not going to help you, which is going to have lot of problems, which we will demonstrate in a laboratory. So another important aspect of this argon thin specimen surface, you can see this micrograph. These are all bright field images of cadmium tellurium showing the defects in the argon thin specimen, and this is an undamaged crystal thin by a reactive iodine iron milling. So you have to be extra careful about this. Iron milling is going to create a lot of surface damage, and in order to use this, you have to keep that fact in mind. It is going to create a lot of defects. So if you don't choose an appropriate parameters for this thinning, here again you are going to spoil your sample, or you may be without noticing this, if you start doing the microscopy, you will be wrongly characterizing the damage which is generated by sample preparation, which you will interpret as the material characteristic, which is quite dangerous. So you have to keep that in mind. So if you want to produce a cross section specimen, then here are some of the procedures which is shown here. The sample is cut into thin slices normal to the interfaces, which are glued together between the spacers, which could be silicon, glass, etc., wider than the slot in the grid. So this is the spacer. So you put all the slices and then put it inside. The club sandwich is then itself glued into the grid and iron milled to the perforation. So the whole thing is put into this spacers, and then it is tightly glued into the grid like this, and then finally iron milled. So this surface get iron milled, and then you will be able to see the cross section specimens. So it's very involved procedure here again. And one of the most conventional way of preparing the sample was through electrolytic polishing, is the window method of for metals and alloys, where you have an electrolytic setup for polishing, electrolytic polishing, and you have a sample window which is completely covered with some kind of a lacquer or so, and then it will go through the sequence of electrolytic etching like this. So we will go through the remarks. A sheet of metal 1 centimeter is lacquered around the edges and made the anode of an electrolytic cell. And if you look at the progress during the thinning, the initial perforation usually occurs at the top of the sheet like this. Lacquer is used to cover the initial perforation, and the sheet is rotated 180 degree like this. The thinning continues to ensure that final thinning occurs near the center of the sheet. If the final edge is smooth rather than jagged, it is probably too thick. So if you have a very thin region, your final specimen will appear like this. If it is a tooth thick, it will be like this. It is true for even a twin jet polishing also. If you have a thin specimen, your final surface will look like, otherwise it will be like this. See, one important advantage of doing this window technique is you will have a large thinning region as compared to a twin jet polished 3mm disc. And here it is not 3mm disc, it is a big window you are getting. So, you will get a very large area of thin region to examine, which is a great advantage for TEM analysis. The another important technique is ultramicrotomy. This is primarily used for a polymeric material, a soft material, and we will just go through the principle, and then here again we will show the actual demonstration in the laboratory how to do this. You see the basic operation is shown in the schematic. You have the base with the knife, and then you have a small trough, we call it as a boat sometime, and the specimen is kept in or stuck with an this is a mobile arm, I would say that, thermally advanced arm, and this is the feed direction like your a lathe, and that is how the specimen moves ups and down, and this is a knife, the dark triangle, and this is a trough. So, the specimen will impinge on the knife edge, and then it will be coming out like this. So, this is the trough in the other view, it is an enlarged view, and this is the knife, and this is your arm, this is how it look like. So, it will cut through like this, the specimen is going to just float on the trough, because the trough will be filled with water, and then you have, this is a cutting surface, and you have the sample here, it is a completely sample block, and the direction of motion is this, up and down. So, it will be taken as a simple a thin section of a desired thickness, and which can be taken with the TEM copper grid. You can just fish it out and then directly look at under the microscope. So, the sample is first embedded in the epoxy or some other medium, or the whole sample is clamped or moved across a knife edge. See, if your sample, this all depending upon the sample dimensions, if you have the very small samples, you have to stick it with an epoxy or something else, or your sample itself, it is a bulk, you can directly clamp it onto the arm and then perform this operation. You produce a thin flakes that floats off onto the water or an appropriate inert medium, from where they are taken onto the copper grid like this. See, another important technique is a replication or an extraction technique, which is very important for some of the analysis of a second phase particle in the metallic specimen. For example, if you have suppose if you have a magnetic sample, for example, iron or a steel and so on, and then you have the second phase particle which is there in the material. In order to obtain the information from the second phase particle alone, and if you put the metal foil also will influence the electron beam, and because of that you will not be able to focus or obtain specific information from the second phase particles. So, in order to take the the information from the second phase particle alone, and this extraction replica technique is being used. See, the one of the way to produce a replica is shown in the schematic. So, you see the bulk sample which has the second phase particle like this. So, after etching, you are going to clean this, and then it will, all your second phase particle will come almost to the top surface, and then you do a coating with typically with a carbon or anything, any 10 film, you coat it, and then you just extract this the carbon film from the bulk. So that will have this kind of a situation where all your second phase particle will stick to this carbon or any thin film which you coat. And if you are able to extract this, since the film is carbon film is extracting this particle from the bulk material, that is why it is called a carbon extraction replica. And this replica can be put on the grid and then you can view it under the microscope. So here it is shown with some kind of a typical plastic, and which will take the impression, and it will, with a chemical etching, you produce this kind of a self-supporting replica. Then you can view it. This is this kind of a technique is for some fracture surface. You can analyze, you take the impression of the fracture surface and then look at the features carefully. And once the replica is produced, then you can just slide it on the water, then it will float like this. So that is also clearly demonstrated. So this is very important technique. If you want to take the information T, or if you want to perform a TEM analysis on a second phase particles without the interference of the matrix, then you will be able to use this technique. And finally, you see that after doing all this jet polishing final polishing, then if you want to clean the surface of the specimen, because after all these things, your specimen is highly corrosive or amenable to all the oxidation and so on, then it is better to clean that surface before you put the specimen in the TEM column. So in order to clean that, you have something called plasma cleaners. The plasma consists of energetic electrons and ions that bombarded the surface and break the carbon hydrogen bonds. With the short duration of exposure, the surface, if the specimen itself is unaffected, the hydrocarbon gradually reduced in the molecular weight and pumped. Oxygen, nitrogen and argon are the most commonly used gases. The hydrocarbon gradually reduced in molecular weight and pumped away in the vacuum of the cleaner. Oxygen, nitrogen and argon are the most commonly used gases for this kind of an operation. So this is the typical plasma cleaner. This is how it looks like. So the instrument and cross section details are shown in this schematic. You have the this is a main housing, and this is the specimen holder, which after it inserts into this chamber, how it look like. So you have the quartz tube, and this is a gas inlet, and which comes and the all the vacuum, the specimen. This is the O-ring with which, you know, the specimen will be inside the vacuum of the microscope. A similar chamber is here, and then the cleaning operation is done. So now what I will do is, I will just quickly go to the laboratory demonstration, and I will just start with a simple low speed saw, and this is a typical diamond blade which is being used to produce any thin section. So we will start with from this, how we proceed with the cutting action. So you have the specimen, you can put it in the diamond saw, slow speed diamond saw. The advantage of this machine is you can produce a sections of very thin sections. You can produce typically 0.1 mm, and these are the details of the equipment. You have the coolant, for these slow speed axon. Some of the coolants are commercially available, so we can directly use it. And the material which is being taken for this demonstration is some aluminum alloy. And you see that it is now almost producing a thin section, and you can and the specimen thin section is I will the thin section is further polished by mechanical thinning. For that it has been pasted on the a bulk sample like this, and then being rubbed on the very fine emery paper, and then you just measure the foil thickness with the micrometer. The thumb rule is it should be below 100 micron, so you have about 67 micron thick foil, and then you take that foil into the punching machine. So this is how the 3M discs are produced in this using the punch machine. Can clearly see the punching action with the punch and the die, and your 3mm discs will be collected in this a container which is kept below this. So after punching this, you can produce as many number of 3mm discs from the a large thin disc which you have mechanically polished, and then you can produce as many specimens as possible from this. You can punch out, and then you will do this jet polishing. Okay. I will stop here, and then I would like to tell you something before we proceed with this jet polishing demonstration. If you do not produce this thin section with the slow speed hacksaw properly, then you will have the problem throughout the subsequent operations. For example, if you want to produce a parallel thin section, it is very important that you remove one section by the diamond blade. You remove that, do not take the first because you may not know whether whatever the sample you are putting for the first cut, is it parallel, the surface is may not be parallel. So in order to produce a parallel surface, you remove first section, do not use it. From the second section, you start using it. You can go up to very thin section depending upon your sample availability. So take that, and also produce the section with a proper cutting parameters. For example, I did not talk about the kind of load you can use for the cutting, the speed and the coolant flow, everything is important. And if you are not following this procedure, then you may spoil the specimen there itself. Or if you produce a tapered section from the slow speed saw itself, then that will carry on. You will have a problem until the final jet polishing. So a slow speed hacksaw, if you know how to use it, you better learn it and then produce a parallel uniform thin section, and then that parallel uniform thin section should be maintained during your mechanical polishing. You should not apply a lot of mechanical force because you will be generating a damage by your own force. So you prepare a very thin section and then get into this 3 mm disc. So now you continue this, we will continue this jet polishing unit. So this is the specimen holder in a twin jet polisher. This, the 3 mm disc is kept in the specimen holder, and then now this will be put it inside the twin jet polishers. So this is a liquid nitrogen bath. We are going to, or now this this is an electrolyte, and then this will be kept in a mixed with a liquid nitrogen bath, and then the setup will be immersed in that. So the electrolyte is being cooled. So the whole the electrolytic thin jet unit is being is kept on the bath, and then you insert the sample in the slot, and now you can look at the polishing recipe on the digital display. And here you can have a standard recipe which is provided by the machine supplier, or you can have your own recipe. As I mentioned in the presentation, the IV characteristics of the sample should be first established, and you have to choose an appropriate electrolyte, voltage, temperature, polishing time, and so on. So the depending upon the specimen and the thickness, the machine gives a kind of a rough range of current and voltage optimized, and then you can choose that guideline and then further proceed with the polishing machine. So what is being now done is just first do a scan that will give you an idea. Depending upon the thickness of your sample, it will give you the appropriate thinning region. So that is called a scan, or I can say that a simple scan. It will show some a rough idea of the polishing IV characteristics. So if you follow that method, you will avoid the spitting, or not pitting region, or as well as or if it is not good enough for the polishing. So in this case, this point has been identified as the polishing region. Then you go ahead with the actual electrolytic polishing. I repeat, the recipe what we are following in this electrolytic method, it is not done in one go. It is done with trial and error. You have to do 2-3 times to see whether you are getting the kind of specimen thinning which you wanted. So what I will do is, I will just go to the thinning. After thinning, this is the important step. Once the thinning is complete, it gives the beep sound, because it will sense the light through the specimen, and then you have to remove this very quickly, and then you have to wash it in an alcohol and much more rigorously. You have to wash 3-4 petri dish, you can keep it, and wash it thoroughly, and then only you will be able to look at, you can see that a small hole, and this is going to be put on the TEM holder. This is the 3 mm disc which is being loaded onto the TEM specimen holder. Yeah, this is the single tilt holder. And now, before we put it into the microscope, this is being cleaned by a plasma cleaner. So, this is a plasma cleaning unit. Again, it has got its own recipe. You have to follow procedures, and since it is done in a vacuum, again you have to check with the vacuum. And like a jet polishing machine, this also has the ready-made recipes available for a type of specimen or a type of operation. So, now the vacuum is on. So, the pumping is being done, and so you will see the so this getting ready now. So, this cleaning is done typically for a few minutes. So, there is a recommendation depending upon the sample. So, typically it is 4 minutes in this case, and then you see that the indication with the glass glow in this schematic, and you can also view through this window how this plasma is getting specimen is getting cleaned by the plasma, and then it is all very simple automatic process. Then now your sample is ready for the viewing in the TEM. So now, so that metallic part is over. Now what we are now going to see is suppose if you have the non-metallic sample in case of a ceramic sample, typically a ceramic sample. Now I will just demonstrate how a ceramic sample is being pre-thinned. For example, it has to go through a dimple grinder, which I just showed in the presentation. And for this dimple grinding, this the simple video which we are now going to show. This is a stub, and this is a glue, typical a polymer based glue which is commercially available. So, you put this glue, you melt it on the hot plate and put a glue on this stub. In this case, for a demonstration purpose, we have not taken a ceramic sample, but it is again a metallic sample just for a demonstration. But typically, a ceramic sample would be it should be used for this kind of thing. So the specimen is being stuck on the sample stage, and this is a magnetic stage, and then you have the a simple microscope to look at the specimen surface and alignment. You can see that. So it'll be done very fast. So you see that now the microscope will be mounted on the specimen stage, so that you can just look at the thinning action. It's a pre-thinning action, I would say. So now you can look at this and then align the specimen stage in order to produce a proper dimple in the center of the 3 mm disc. So, that is very important. You have to produce a dimple in the center of the sample. That is why this microscope is used. Then you choose again here an appropriate parameters. So you have the grinding wheel which will touch on the sample, and that this is the dial gauge which controls the thickness. So you can control the thickness in microns, and then the speed of the grinding wheel is controlled. And you here again you have a specified recipe, or you have to arrive at your own recipe for thinning it. And this is a ceramic abrasive glue which is placed on the specimen, and then now the grinding action will takes place, that is dimbling action. You can see that the specimen stage is also rotating in order to produce a uniform a dimple at the center. So this is how the dimpling is done. So it is very important that the dimpling is done in the center of the specimen, and after this dimpling you can take this sample for the further thinning in the iron miller. So this is a pre-thinning, typical pre-thinning operation for as I mentioned, it's a ceramic sample. So after this this sample is taken to the iron miller, or if you are dimpling in a bulk sample, you have to produce a 3 mm disc. A 3 mm disc cannot be produced with the disc punch which we have shown, because only metallic specimens are prepared by the disc punch. So for a ceramic material, you have something called an ultrasonic disc cutter. With that you prepare a 3 mm a disc of specimen from the ceramic sample, then you can perform this dimpling action, then go to iron miller. So there are three stages. In the next class I will demonstrate how the ultrasonic disc cutter functions, and then followed by the iron milling equipment, and then we will move on to the next technique. Thank you.